I'm here with Alex Nota, associate professor at Tallinn Tech University. He's going to give a demo of CPM tools. It is a tool to, I suppose, use PetriNets.
Yes, that's right. Okay, thank you so much. And before I do that, I just want to show in what context I've used this. So yesterday I sent out an email listening to the discussion that I worked on a bunch of papers about cross-organizational business process collaboration, basically to automate truck production. So this was part of an EU project. We had these truck producers and so here's I think you have all received the email, so you just click on the links and then you see this one. So here's the PetriNet story of my cross-organizational collaboration model. And conceptually this used as an external process level to which you project process views. You have a conceptual process level in-house where you hide things. And then here you have an internal process level for orchestration. So out here you perform choreography, and in here you perform orchestration of these systems. And I mean, you can read the paper yourself, but just the model here. And that's something we observed, of course, in an informal way, what goes on with those truck producers. They have a large in-house process where they understand, at least MIN had, understand how to produce a truck so that the entire process terminates correctly. And then, let's say, this is a consumer sphere producing a water tank for a sprinkler system. This is, of course, a toy example, but I mean, it's just to show the structural properties. And you you project here the sphere to an external level, and then a service provider must match himself into this. And here the assumption is that you're kind of isomorphic. But then in-house you have a much larger process with extra elements, so you can have parallel branches, loops, or insert extra states, and the rest you can then read yourself. Just the conclusion I came to was this is a little bit tricky from a computational point of view, so I moved to these process trees. So here's a static, this is the equivalent story to this wood format. And then converted here basically to, well, using a BPMN model deriving from that process trees, then for matching, quite similar to what I did with the PetriNets earlier. So that's one paper. Then I have another paper before I get to the demo. This is the dynamic story with tree-based matching. So here the assumption is that your processes can evolve over time once you enter the runtime space. And then you have certain operators you can use. So here's a little toy example, once again using BPMN. We map this to trees, and then we have here these operators. You can add something, delete something, and so forth. And then you have to follow certain rules so that the evolving process still remains sound, cross-organizationally. Yeah. So
I have two questions.
Yeah.
Should I ask them later?
Yes.
So the first question is, which leads up to the second question. So are you ever in a situation where you've got this process in a description and you want to, say, simplify it or change it to a different one, and you want to make sure that there's some relationship between the new one and the old one? Do you ever do that kind of thing?
I mean, a simplification would be actually an evolution. So you can delete certain steps.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a delete operator.
Right, right.
And then if you just follow what we mapped out in the paper, you actually have that.
Yeah. So technically,
it's just a series of deletions.
Yeah.
And then per deletion, you do it correctly according to the rules in the paper, then you simplify your collaboration.
Okay, so technically, do you ever use PetriNet morphisms?
So in the earlier paper I showed you, we use isomorphism.
Uh-huh.
I mean for the external matching.
Yeah.
And then of course the in-house process has to be as subclass behavior wise. And for that, there's some algebraic notions so for which I would now check the paper again to remember them. But of course, they also have to match. And this is behavior-wise, it's not pass.
Yeah.
But it's computationally quite challenging, so I switched over to BPMN and process trees.
Right.
That's the point I'm trying to make. Then here, and here we actually get into... So this is then a paper about how you deal with conflict resolution in these process collaborations. And I assume that you have a multi-agent system layer on top of it's basically this type of model. So here you have the larger process where you have the service types where the service offers match themselves in. Is the larger in-house process, and all of this I translated. Yeah, and on top you have if certain rules are violated, like here, so we have certain conflicts that occur for choosing whom, I mean, a shipper of the finished goods, and then you end up, so yeah, you end up with certain conflict types, and here you see a color picture net. So this entire picture here, I translated into a color picture net demo, which I can show in moments. And just very briefly, just to finish it off here, these last three papers are about the life cycle of setting up such a collaboration, rolling it out, enacting it when things go wrong, rolling it back orderly so that your business semantics remains under tight control, that you don't create a lot of trash in your life cycle, and orderly terminating. That you also clean up behind yourself. And for that, I also used kind of picture nets. So it's all here, and this I can also still quickly demo. But okay, so that's the overview of the papers. And then here's the actual tool, which you can freely download. And so it's fully documented, you download it. Unfortunately, I can't run it anymore on the Linux, but the Windows version still looks nicely. And so it's not really maintained anymore because it's kind of matured, and we would need some fresh patch maybe to continue working on it. But yeah, everything is here. You can it started the many nice videos. It's even a Facebook website.
So what kind of things do these tools allow you to do?
Yeah, can we see?
Yes, let's see the demo. Okay, so here's the actual tool, and this is, it's a bit small. Okay, so what you can create is it's like a visual programming environment where you create these graphs. And this is actually from the one paper I showed, the proof of concept example. And so, yeah, what you do is you specify here states and transitions, and here you have token definitions. So here you have types. So over here you have all your types that you actually use for the states, and here's your set of variables, and here are your pages. Okay, so the highest one is called conflict resolution. So yeah, here you have your tools, which you can just drop here into a page, and then just have to move this a little bit over. Yes. So you can create those state transition systems, which you can also hierarchically nest. Like here, you have a module. Yeah, input states and output states, and then you can dive into a subpage, which is further defined here. So let me pull this one over. Yes. And in the end, what you can do is you can simulate the entire net. Not only that, you can of course do all sorts of model checking. So if I go back here. Like what I did in this paper, so you can do state space analysis, which I mean I talked about this. So here are some results of the state space analysis of this particular, where you can check for performance peaks, if you have loops, lifeless, if you have empty states, home markings, dead markings, and so on. And in my case, I ran into this issue of how to deal with the size of the state space. It's done automatically, you get a report, and then you can analyze basically the report output that gives you information about the properties of the net. But what you can also do is do a simulation. And let's do this here. So, so I can simulate the entire net automatically. Let's just give that a try. So you see here, so when I start a net, it's a bit like an interpreted environment. The entire tool, the tool checks the entire net and gives you immediately feedback if something is wrong. And besides these fully automated state space analysis checks, I can do a simulation. So like here I simulate 50 steps, so let's crank this actually up. Drop this reset options, let's say instead of 50 I do 500 steps. Okay, I choose the tool and then I play a token game. So here you see this transition is enabled to fire. So the assumption here is that you have production of tires. And here you have then three service suppliers. This one is the other one. In brownish, and here is the last one in green. And this is kind of some extra orchestration framework process that allows you to basically plug in these suppliers. So the rules, the reason why I chose CPN tools there was because we used so-called declare rules. And actually CPN tools has been extended by Michael Vestergaard once upon a time with declare rules, but unfortunately that didn't work out. So the declare rules are used in this conflict management paper I have to map into StandardML. And they're distributed here in this process and also here on the conflict resolution side. So the assumption is here, you have agents per supplier, and the consumer actually has two. And there's this conflict which occurs for what shipper is.
Alex, when I look at this, this looks like spaghetti. I don't see anything.
Yeah, so can I get the name?
Is there like a more modular way to look at these systems?
The thing is, it's the CPN tools. Let me do the demo. It's very good to study in complex systems concurrency conflicts and dependability issues. And it's precisely that the logics gives you this, what you call spaghetti.
I mean like, just looking at the picture, it looks like the system
this one.
Looks like spaghetti.
Here, the conflict is that the tokens contain type terms. So this is like, the tokens in here are of type integer times string times boolean. And these things, this is like pattern matching.
Mm-hmm. No, but when I look at the overall code, it looks like some kind of a Kafkaesque nightmare, right?
I guess what Paul's saying
business process are like
this is not a business process. So the business process level happens down here, which is much cleaner. And what I show there on the top level, that's the conflict. These are the multi-agent systems. The way they are developed and exchanged with each other, they don't follow a clear process. But their behavior is, here you could have some game theoretical conflict resolution. So they just have to negotiate the terms until they reach an agreement on the high level, and then basically the agreement, which is overall, a consensus, that is then pushed down again to this lower level. Of the process, where then once the conflict is resolved, you can orderly run to the end of the process. Yeah, Let me just show them the demo and mean the token thing. So I can do manual binding if I wish. So here this process is enabled. I have a unique start with the lifecycle ID, and here just choose some type specifications. So okay, I choose a lifecycle ID, and then let's say thousands, and then a file.
So this set. Find all the tokens where P is 1 and TS is 100.
Yes.
So there's two tokens here and three tokens here.
Yes. So then I move on in the process. So I can do this I can do the manual binding of the values into the token colors if I wish to simulate. But then I can also do this semi-automatic simulation. Or actually, in this case, I mean, I just click, and now 500 firings basically happen. So I'm running through the entire process. And basically the
you see, this is kind of what I was trying to say before is that this reminds me of the state of programming languages before Dijkstra-Rhodes Go-To considered harmful, right? Just adding one transition from one part of the net to another will just completely change the semantics.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not visible because the net itself is not structured.
Yeah.
The lower level net is structured, basically if I stop here quickly. So this part of the net here, this is structured. This follows clearly a structure which I can reveal in the paper. So this is really the business process level. Let me crank up the paper.
But the software doesn't have a structure.
No.
One of the problems with a lot of these pitching net tools is that like when people are drawing it, it's like, where you've drawn the things, your bit of code, and then you're the only person that understands it.
Yeah.
So
the
low level
of engineering, I think, that things become like less than mathematics.
This is why GoTo is considered helpful.
Yeah.
Not because it's you that's advantage.
In here,
the programmer understands it.
Yeah, guys, it's not
but
like as nice and elegant as we're used to, but it's very relevant to what we're doing. So I mean,
here you have no GoTo. So what I'll show. So this part, this is a composed workflow net in the end, if you collapse it. So this is very, very clean.
Okay,
I have here extras. So the backbone is a workflow net, but then I kind of limit the expressiveness of my model to essentially workflow net plus, then I add in a fine-dosed way data flow semantics in, okay, so that I can express this production of a tire. I have certain business rules at certain points that get violated, and when the conflict starts, I move to the multi-agent system level. And I'm not sure if you've ever developed multi-agent systems, but they're definitely not structured. So you have inside of an agent, you have a set of rules, and these agents, they can just talk to each other in a spontaneous, autonomous way. And so there's no structure like here. On a lower level where you have this workflow net, basically, which is quite easy to follow. There's a unique start state, which is here. Then you basically run through the process from left to right. And here on the right side is your unique end state. It's here. Sorry, unique end state. And once you reach that state, then with the exception of some kind of logging states where you try to capture maybe some information about the process execution, but the rest really remains empty. So this is quite clean, but of course multi-agent systems, their behavior is much more chaotic. Okay? So they have to resolve a conflict. So this I mean, they have internal, some interesting rules, and then they just engage and try to negotiate until they reach a consensus about the value of which shipboard needs to be chosen, and then that is pushed out again, this outcome, to the more structured external level here, which is rather easy to follow if you understand what Fluent Semantics. But yes, this looks like spaghetti because it's just the nature of the multi-agents that their engagement is much more ad hoc and chaotic. So of course then you get all these extra spaghetti. Yeah, I mean, you have your alternatives to negotiate, you have a mismatch, you have a match. It's actually quite clear. So these are all states which are necessary if you understand here these agents still communicate with each other. Right. So in a sense, I mean, you do express very precisely the behavior, I mean, first of all, the structure of the overall system. You can simulate it, and you can really, in a very fine-tuned and surgical way, study the concurrency conflicts and dependability issues. And that's why it ends up looking a bit like this. Yeah. Certainly on the multi-agent system level.
Maybe you are a little bit objective to this. You yourself have a high-level view of this process, the composition of certain process models, certain multi-agent systems, altogether one big system.
Yes.
So that vision, that understand, that structure that's in your head, is not shown to me by the tool, right?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
So for example, so maybe you can show.
Here you have the conflict resolution master page, and these are the sub pages. You see? So this is the top page where the multi-agent systems are. Mm-hmm. And here you have the external layer of collaboration, so that's here. And then you have the embedded sub-layers.
Can you zoom out?
Yes.
I think that the main thing here is that Pavel means compositionality in a strict categorical sense.
In any sense. I mean, it just means that there's a lot of stuff, and it's hard to understand all. But if there was, you know, like, if you cut that into five different blocks,
But see them down here. So this is, these are the hierarchically nested pages. Here, you see?
Well, maybe a different, like a comment on it. So I think part of the spaghetti look of this thing is the way it's visually done. I think like this, once you start doing visual programming, you need to be really like hysterical about it being like very good looking. It's really difficult. And I don't think CPM tools succeeded in that. I mean, just the fact that all these circles are not actually circles, I mean, these are places, but they're all different. Your brain doesn't like this.
Yeah.
Right? And they're all white. This thing is white and that thing is white, but also this one. So this is part of the way why it looks like spaghetti. Other reason why it looks like spaghetti is a lot of business processes are like spaghetti. But if you now were to write this out in regular code, that's incomprehensible.
Sure, that's really the structure.
No, you do. But I think there's, like, you see, this is not entirely unstructured, so some stuff is
This is clearly work from it. So,
here's
the start.
Alex's vision of this is much more high level than the picture you're showing us.
Yeah.
Right, so it would be cool if the tool itself showed you this high level vision. You can then focus on one particular piece, zoom down and see the internal section. And that would also stop you from doing something stupid like connecting the internal place of one component directly to an internal place of some other component on the other side.
It's not possible. So I mean,
but why is not possible?
Hang on. It is actually. But what I do is, I mean, you have these modules. So like here, this is a module. You know, it has these input and output states, and I can dive in here. It's over there.
This one here.
Let's move this one. So this is then what the internal state looks like of this particular agent. And here those double lines states are the carry in and out labels, so then they're basically the input and output states of this particular
of this particular.
So how do I know what's wiring to what?
This thing?
like these arrows then coming in and out of this module, how do I know that they're actually wired to?
Because, so you have here those input and output states.
Yeah. Well, which ones, how do I know which ones are wired to which arrows?
So, for example, let's check replace. So here's the replace.
Yeah.
Same name.
Yeah, that's the same name. And here, let's go here. Oops. Here's the replace. It's an input state.
Oh, okay. So these input states and output states are explicitly inside the...
Yes.
Bonus.
Yeah.
Oh, same. Okay.
And of course, I mean, this must identity match, of course, so that you can bind this page of type config resolution very surgically into this module, which you create yourself. You see? That's how it works. And thereby, you can reduce the complexity of the net and create these modules, which are actually reusable. So, if you have some other place in your system for, let's say, this particular type config resolution agent, you can just reuse that page and plug that in on a high level at some other part of the module. Yes, okay, time's up. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and maybe one thing. So you have then here all these CPN ML states. So I try to keep them simple, but of course here you can program entire functions. But the problem is if you have parallel branches, say, and you have very complex functions going on, you create nightmarish parallel algorithms, which are very hard to resolve. So I'm very careful with how far I go with the functional programming in CPN ML on the ARCs. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.